very special Cynthia, and that is really kind of our theme this morning as we wrap up our summer focus upon the book of Job about God's blessings in disguise. I like it that way. Greetings to you. Welcome to worship at St. Martin's. Shall we pass the peace together? Remember how? Our hands together. Peace coming together to be with you and also with you. Amen. Blessings and welcome. Today it's Youth Sunday, but it's the fifth Sunday. Are they going to come and make an announcement? Okay. So I said, when they come, I want to know, so where are they in school and what year are they? Everybody will tell us so we can get a look at them. Come up here in front so everybody can get a look at you.
Okay. Welcome to Youth Sunday. If you want to know what grade they're in, yeah. I'll have to tell you because I don't know.
Junior, yeah, eighth grade,
sophomore,
freshman,
eighth grade,
senior,
eighth grade.
Very good, thank you.
Okay, so we're glad to see everybody back in church. Glad all the kids are here. They are holding the lottery tickets that I have on board so far for our raffle in place of our fall festival. Right now, we're right at $900, so thank you very much. I will put it on Facebook tonight, and it'll have a Venmo attachment to it, so people can pay that way. Or if you'd like tickets to sell, raise your hand, and I'll have some of the kids come by and hand some to you. It's one for a dollar a piece, or six for five. And then we will draw the winning ticket on October 3rd in church that morning. So.
Terry.
Yes.
Introduce our other three that were busy in the
room. Oh, okay. Tell what grade you're
in. I'm Annabelle, I'm a junior. I'm Catherine, I'm a freshman.
And I am Marta, and I'm senior.
And tell them where you're from.
I'm from Barcelona, Spain.
So I'm here on time.
Okay, thank you. If you need some of those tickets, raise your hand and the kids will bring this home. And we'll get this on Facebook and hopefully everybody can sell some extras and we'll make a little money. Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Nice to meet you. Good looking cars. I don't know how many got you. Good looking cars. On the yard, Mr. Chris came with the announcement that the Men's Fellowship would like to have a meeting on the 22nd of September at 7 p.m. here at the church. So I'd like to go to that event, if you will. Are there other announcements? Nothing else to lift up. Well, let's talk about the birthdays that we know about then. Kathy Hofstetter has a birthday this week. Nancy Vine, how many?
52.
52, congratulations. Amalia, also, right? Where is she? How many?
14.
Sophia Stout. Betty Hawk has a birthday. Where is she? Is she here? She in office? It has a zero in it.
She's 30.
No, okay. And Dave Jones has a birthday this week. I said you have a birthday this week with a zero in it.
Yes, I do. 70!
And then also, Harold and Becky Selby have a wedding anniversary this week, number 44. And the Jatinskis, Alex and Daniel, in your room service. You're nice to have a wedding anniversary this week. Let's sing together.
Yes, I'm on birthday.
Yes, I'm sorry. Oh, Mary. Yes?
Yes, I have a birthday tomorrow.
Tomorrow. Congratulations. Yes, we have Stella.
Mine's 24, I'm
14. 14, congratulations. Let's sing the happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Dr.
listed. We want to add to our prayer concerns the family of Charles Scott, who is a friend of June Roberts. Also, we want to hold Brad Hook in our prayers, who's a son-in-law of Elaine Veland Gilligan. Laura Poole has a surgery coming up this week. Rob has a surgery this week. Looking forward to it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Keeping our, the Trigg family in our prayers, Timothy Trigg, who passed away recently. Are there other joys or concerns to share? Yes. Yes, and I want to call attention to those soldiers who lost their lives this week here in a moment. Yeah, our brothers and all of our neighbors in the South who are racing down for yet another Katrina kind of a storm this morning. Sure enough. Let's bow our heads. I want to share the names of these 13 soldiers then who lost their lives this week. Lord, we come to you and we want to stand shoulder to shoulder with the families of these who answered the call of duty, who pledged to serve their neighbors and to protect, and who were victims of violence. We remember Marine Corps Lance Corporal David Espinosa, Marine Corps Sergeant Nicole G., Marine Corps Staff Sergeant Darren Taylor Hoover, Army Staff Sergeant Ryan Canales, Marine Corps Corporal Hunter Lopez, Marine Corps Lance Corporal Riley McCullum, Marine Corps Lance Corporal Dylan R. Marola, Marine Corps Lance Corporal Kareem Nikoi, Marine Corps Corporal Megan William Tyler, Marine Corps Sergeant Johnny Rosario, Marine Corps Corporal Humberto Sanchez, Marine Corps Lance Corporal Jared Smith from Wentzville, Missouri, Navy Hospital Corpsman Mark Soliak. Lord, we thank you for their service to their neighbors and for the life that they live and the example that they set. We continue in prayer, Lord, and we want to share that often we feel that the road that we travel is lonely in this world, and we can't imagine that others hurt as much as we do sometimes. We cannot believe that they long as much as we do for understanding and compassion, or that they feel as handicapped to make a modest success of their lives. And our confusion and our grief seems greater than anyone else's sometimes. And then we remember our Savior and the road which he walked. He was tempted in every way, like as we are. And in the end, everyone deserted him, and he was put to death as a common criminal, mocked and tortured. And you raised him up, O God. You glorified him in spite of the lonely road that he walked. And so help us to identify with Christ, to hear him calling to us, to follow him in the way of the cross. Turn us from our lonely way into his way, and let the power and the glory that were in him be in us. Give us eyes to see what you are doing in the world and to be your servants where you need us. Use us to touch the lives of others walking their own roads, and take what we have to combat hunger and injustice and evil. Like the heroes of our faith and these heroes whom we remember today, let us become faithful followers of the way of Christ. Make us courageous, generous, loving, and caring, so that one day there may be no lonely roads for anyone, but that all may be gathered together in adoration and praise around the throne of the Almighty, there to sing your praises forever, and to live as one of all the saints who have gone before us, who surround us now, even as we pray the way that Jesus taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And while I remember, we will have a new member orientation after worship today. We'll meet in the fellowship hall to welcome folks into fellowship. Thanks. You here today?
Good morning. Good morning. Today's scripture comes from Job 40:1-5. Job 41, 1 through 10, Job 42, 1 through 6. Job, you challenged Almighty God. Will you give up now, or will you answer? I spoke foolishly, Lord. What can I answer? I will not try to say anything else. I have already said more than I should. Can you catch Leviathan with a fish hook, or tuck his tongue down with a rope? Can you put a rope through his snout, or put a hook through his jaws? Will he beg you to let him go? Will he plead with you for mercy? Will he make an agreement with you and promise to serve you forever? Will you tie him like a pet bird, like something to amuse your servant woman? Will fishermen bargain over him? Will merchants cut him up to sell? Can you fill his hide with fishing spears or pierce his head with a harpoon? Touch him once and you'll never try it again. You'll never forget the fight. Anyone who sees Leviathan loses courage and falls to the ground. When he is aroused, he is fierce. No one would dare to stand before him. Can you catch Leviathan with a fish hook? Or tie his tongue down with a rope? Can you put a rope through his snout or put a hook through his jaws? Will he beg you to let him go? Will he plead with you for mercy? Will he make an agreement with you and promise to serve you forever? Will you tie him like a pet bird, like something to amuse your servant women? Will you fishermen bargain over him? Will merchants cut him up to sell? Can you fill his hide with fishing spears or pierce his head with a harpoon? Touch him once and you'll never try it again. You'll never forget the fight. Anyone who sees Leviathan loses courage and falls to the ground. The next scripture comes from Psalm 13. How much longer will you forgive me, Lord? Forever? How much longer will you hide yourself from me? How long must I endure trouble? How long will sorrow fill my heart day and night? How long will my enemies triumph over me? Look at me, O Lord, my God, and answer me. Restore my strength. Don't let me die. Don't let my enemies say, "We have defeated him." Don't let them gloat over my downfall. I rely on your constant love. I will be glad because you will rescue me. I will sing to you, O Lord, because you have been good to me.
Let's stand and unite in this historic confession of our Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He descended into heaven and stood at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, one holy universal Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Amen. I appreciate the dramatic energy you gave to that last reading from the book of Job for today. God finally answers Job from the whirlwind today. All that talk about Leviathan, by the way, the sea creature Leviathan, it's why God's people were afraid of the sea. It represented evil. And God had cast Leviathan there, this creature that represents the devil and represents the Satan. Do you know this story? God created Adam and Eve and he put them in the garden and he told them, don't eat from the tree of knowledge. And they ate from it, and then God came looking for them and said, what did you do? You did what I told you not to do, and how do you explain yourself? And Adam said, I don't know, it's her fault. She told me to do it. And God said to Eve, did you do that? And he said, well, I guess so. I guess I did. But how come? Why couldn't we eat from that tree? And God said, because I said so. That's why, and that should be enough. And Adam and Eve had no answer for themselves, and so God cursed them, and their curse was that they should have children just like themselves. That's a paraphrase, but my mother spoke that curse over me. How about you? You should have children just like yourself. Job gets his answer today. We've been these summer months, looking at Job's complaint, his responses to suffering. Job responds by lamenting and worshiping, by protesting. He responds in anger, he responds with resignation, with trust. And today we consider Job's acceptance. Job's acceptance. It's the last stage of grief, if you know those terms, to accept. It doesn't mean that what happened to Job was okay, but what Job desired the most finally comes to pass. Remember, we've talked about the fact that Job's situation, his suffering, doesn't represent just an individual's suffering, but it represents the people of God, God's people, his chosen ones, who wondered when they were carted off into Babylonian exile, just what does it mean we're chosen if we still have to put up with this stuff? Why doesn't God keep us from this? We started by wondering, what's the thing that Job feared the most? He says, the thing I feared the most has happened. Was it losing his family? Was it losing his stuff? Was it losing his health? No, Job feared the most that he had lost his intimate relationship with God. And Job remains faithful. He never gives up desiring God. Finally, today then, we read that Job gets just what he wants, and God kind of cleans his clock when he shows up. He kind of puts him in his place. Remember, the story of Job begins with a test. Does Job only serve God because of what he gets out of it? Does he only serve God when things are going well? And in the end, Job keeps faith that God will show up. What he needs, what he wants the most, is to know that God is still there, and God proves himself in a profound way by giving Job the experience of God's presence. I was thinking about that experience of God's presence. In the end, that's what Job got. It's what he wanted the most, for God to show God's self, to be there with him and to be there for him, ensuring that God was still on his throne and God was still in heaven. I read a wonderful book recently called Hello from Heaven, and it details stories of dozens and dozens of people who tell about having had a visit from a loved one who passed away, who had gone to heaven, who had died. And it says that it believes, this book Hello from Heaven, that maybe 50% of everyone who has lost a loved one has had some sort of a visit in one way or another. Do you have such an experience that you would admit to? Lots of people don't, because they think people would think they're nuts. And I'm not going to quote from the book, but I've had some personal experiences. When I was a hospice chaplain, I visited with a family. And one by one, the four siblings called me and said, you know, I don't know who else to talk to about this, but I saw a figure by my mother's bed just as she breathed her last breath. And I think it looked like it was my father. One sibling after another told me that separately, but they hadn't told each other about it. I said, I think your dad's telling you to talk to each other. Each of Lynn's parents, in their last hours in hospice, Lynn's dad saw a cousin named Mike, who had only passed away just days before. He spoke his name before he breathed his last breath and said, I'm coming to you. Lynn's mother was in our home when she died, and she looked off into the corner of the room somewhere, and she said, they're taking good care of me. Well, that's good. We got a pat on the back with whoever it was. They're taking good care of me. And I myself, when I had those radiation treatments in 2016, I was laying on that wonderful MRI bed. Have you been there in the tube? And I felt something brush up against me. There was no one in the room, but it felt like a pat on the shoulder. I still don't know who it was. Lynn thinks it was her mother. I'm not sure who it was, but I felt a calming touch during that time. And then we lived in a parsonage in Creve Coeur for 6 years, and we would smell perfume in the house, perfume that we knew nobody wore in our house. We decided it was a former preacher's wife. We called her Martha. And whenever we smelled the perfume, we would know she was there, thanking us for taking care of the congregation. God gives us these appearances. God gives us this presence. And it's what Job desires the most. And in the end, he's reminded that God was there all the while. His suffering clouded his vision. But God sent Christ to Calvary to remind us that at times when we suffer, God is there with us too. God knows our sufferings and shares them with us, that we must not fear about bearing them alone. I want us to think a little bit today about some of those other experiences of the presence of God in the scripture. First, I thought about Adam and Eve again. You know, God appeared to them daily in the garden. They had this wonderful, intimate experience of God. And of course, this folk story about Adam and Eve represents the nature of humanity. We were created in this perfect relationship with God. But the Bible has the same story over and over again. You know, that's God creates perfection, we disobey. God judges, we ask for forgiveness. God forgives, and it starts over again. The Bible is the same story over and over and over again. Adam and Eve tell it first, and they tell it best. This story from Genesis says when God comes into the garden after they have done what they weren't supposed to do, they hide. Imagine feeling like you could hide from God. In fact, Psalm 139 says, go ahead and try to hide from God. I bet you can't do it. No matter where we go, we can't flee from God's presence. And so in the end, if we feel like Job does for much of this passage we've read this summer, it's not that God isn't present, but it's that we've chosen to try and hide in some way for some reason. Or maybe our condition, our circumstances caused us to feel like we have put some distance between us. God is present. God is always present. There's no way to go away from God's presence. What a wonderful assurance that we can take away from this study of Job together this summer. Then I thought about Moses. Moses spoke to God like they were best friends. And then Moses said, you know what, in reward for all that I've done, I would like to get a glimpse of your glory. God says, okay, but if you look at my face, you're going to die. Job doesn't get to be in the presence of God directly. What he gets to see is God's backside. He gets to see God from the back. And so God passes by. And Job gets a glimpse of God's mercy and God's glory. It's one of the reasons why I like those stories about the Chronicles of Narnia so much, because Jesus is depicted as Aslan, the lion of Judah. It's a savior with some teeth in him. I like that. I like that a lot. And what C.S. Lewis says about Aslan, the lion who represents Christ, is he is safe, but he's not tame. He's safe, but he's not tame. Moses was reminded that God is God. And Job had to be reminded of that too. God is God. And God doesn't serve us. We're called to worship God, to serve God, to praise God. And if we do that, we're in right relationship with God. We are righteous, and we'll live in God's presence all the time, so long as we remember that God is God. Who did we talk about next? Is it Jacob? Jacob, good old Jacob, stole his brother's birthright. Esau, his big, ugly, hairy twin brother. Stole his birthright, and he was on the lam. He was running, and he stopped at a place called Bethel, and he slept on a rock. Do you remember the story? He saw a vision of a stairway to heaven. They wrote a song about it. Are you still with me? He saw the angels of God coming and going. And he woke up and he said, surely God's in this place. And I didn't know it. God's in this place. And I didn't know it. God's in this place. And I didn't know it. I think the story of Jacob in the presence of God is important because it reminds us that every time God comes to God's people, it's God's initiative. We can seek God all we want to, and it's important to desire God. But every story in the Bible where God appears, it's God's initiative. We may learn to expect to be surprised by the presence of God and to expect God to take the initiative. Don't we need that word right now for these days? I think we do. And then the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah went to church one day, just like we went to church, and by golly, he was surprised God showed up. Isaiah said, when I entered the temple, I saw, and by the way, in the year that King Uzziah died, who knows what year that is, I don't know, but it says that the people were hungry for leadership. It says the nation was mourning. It said the people wondered if there was anybody who was in charge that knew what the heck they were doing. Does that sound familiar? The year that the people wondered if anybody was going to be a leader, God showed up in the temple and called Isaiah to take a stand, called Isaiah to step up and do something about the injustice that he saw. The first thing that happens to the prophet Isaiah is he says, woe is me, I am unclean. And so when we truly experience the presence of God, we're going to experience true humility. We're going to realize that God's holy and we're not. And so people who know the presence of God, who dwell in the presence of God, also live in humility. And the next thing that happens is Isaiah says, send me. Send me. A true experience of the presence of God will send us with a mission. A mission to tell others to share the fact that we've seen the Lord. We've been present with God, and people ought to see that in us if we truly have experienced God's presence. What about the New Testament? I ask myself. You might be wondering. And one day Jesus takes with him up onto a mountaintop the disciples, Peter and James and John, and he shows them his divinity. He shines in full glory before them so they can see that he truly is the Messiah. They have this experience of the presence of God. And the disciples say, this is cool. We ought to build an altar. We ought to make a monument. And Jesus says, no, we've got some work to do. We have to go down from here and go and do good works. Truly to experience this presence of God, truly to live in the presence of God, calls us then to be a people with a mission. A people who share God and who show God to others. And then I thought just one more time that the Bible says wherever two or three are gathered, that we may count on God being present. Did I make a slide? I don't know that I did. But Jesus says in Matthew 18, this is at the end of a lesson that Jesus gives about how to fight fair. It's a lesson in conflict management for the church. If your brother sins against you, if you've got somebody that you're holding a grudge against, go talk to them about it. Don't talk to somebody else about it. Go talk to them directly about it. And if that doesn't work, take somebody else with you. And if that doesn't work, then treat them like a tax collector. I like that. The goal is to live in unity and to live in community. And Jesus says then, wherever two or three agree, wherever two or three come together in my name, I'm there. This wonderful promise means that I count more than two or three. We have a quorum. It means that Christ has promised to be in our midst right now. But Jesus, the living Lord, has promised that we could experience his presence in this very moment and in this very room. Jesus is alive, and Jesus is present with us. What is it that you need from God today? Do you desire God like Job? Has he felt absent? Do you desire healing? Does your spirit need to be calmed? God is present. Christ has promised to be near us whenever we come here and call on him. What does this acceptance look like? It means that we've learned with Job that bad things happen to good people. There's injustice in the world. We can expect the worst to happen sometime. But also we can expect God to be present with us, not to keep us away from heartbreak, but to share it and to help to lift our burden. You know, when Mary Sheriff passed away not too long ago, I was searching for the right words. And if you go down to their home, have you been there? It's down about a mile and a half or two, windy gravel road. Paul is still down there by himself, living in the middle of the woods somewhere. I used to go down there in my little red car. I thought I'd never come back out. But I thought about that road when I thought about the words to share about Mary. And there was a young woman who had been touted as the new laureate of the age of the millennials. Cleo Wade had written a poem called The Road. And that road, to me, and you know, true art, you can read into it however you want to read into it. To me, that road became the presence of God himself. Let me share Cleo Wade's words, because I think they represent this acceptance that we can learn from Job about the way that God deals with us. She writes, I said to the road, where do you lead? The road said, be a leader and find out. I said to the road, what happens when I get there? And the road said, don't worry about the destination. Just focus on the journey. I said to the road, is it a race? The road said, yes, but it's only between you and yourself. I said to the road, well, will it be difficult? And the road said, sometimes. I said to the road, I'm scared. And the road said, that's okay. I said to the road, what if I can't do it? And the road said, you can. I said to the road, how do I start? And the road said, one step at a time. I said to the road, which way do I go? And the road said, only you can decide that. I said to the road, will I get lonely? The road said, you are never alone. I said to the road, what if I need help? And the road said, don't be afraid to ask. I said to the road, but what if I fail? And the road said, I'll be there when we land, when you fall. I said to the road, what if something tries to hold me back? The road said, you will overcome. I said to the road, what if I change? And the road said, good, that's what happens when you grow. I said to the road, will I always move forward? And the road said, not always. I said to the road, what if I have to take two steps back? And the road said, use them to take a giant leap forward. I said to the road, what if I need to stand still? The road said, rest, take care of yourself. And I said to the road, what if a passerby scorns me on the journey? The road said, then shine the light of your love on them. And I said to the road, what if the world feels so dark that I can't see my way? And the road said, shine the light of your love on it. And I said to the road, what do I do if I get lost? The road said, have faith. I said to the road, what do I do if I get weary? The road said, keep going. I said to the road, what if the hills get steep? The road said, keep going. I said to the road, what if the valleys get deep? Keep going. What if it storms? What if something unexpected happens? Keep going. What if I get my heart broken? Keep going. But what if giving up is easier? Keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. I said to the road, where do you lead? The road said, be a leader and find out. The comfort in these words is the ultimate answer that Job gets. God doesn't promise that we won't fall, we won't take steps back, that it won't be hard, that we won't get lost. But God promises that at the end of the road, we will have grown in faith. We will have grown in righteousness. We will have grown in love. God has fixed it so our losses and our sufferings only serve to strengthen our faith if we live in God's presence. Amen. Amen. During our offering time, I invite you to think about how you need the presence of God and how we can experience right now here together today.
Thank you.
should announce, I guess it's okay, the worship committee met this week. We are working on a plan for the time frame for vaccinated singers and ringers to get together again sometime soon. God bless us with that. My prayer from the Lord, we dedicate these gifts. We dedicate all the gifts that you have given us as a sign for us to share your presence that we experience when we gather together with the scattered world as we go. Send us, like you sent Isaiah, with the charge to tell others that you are a God who cleanses and who calls. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We can sing it back. Do you want to sing? Let's stand and sing it for our benediction.
technological and also possible.